Wanted to tell you about my bolo. This bolo tie I have reminds me of a patient I had a long time ago. And I wear it when I give talks as a symbol of communication. And that's what this whole conference is about, right? It's about crosstalk between patients and their providers, between mental health providers and medical providers. But Mr. Schroeder was an older man from Germany who became one of my primary care patients. And we had a great relationship. And one day he had chest pain, ended up going to the emergency room, went to cath. So he was getting a cardiac cath, an angiogram. During his angiogram, he had a stroke, but no one noticed. It gave him aphasia, so he couldn't speak very readily. And none of the doctors, none of the nurses noticed he'd had a stroke. And they finished the angiogram and sent him home. And the next day he came into my office and he was fine, he could walk. And he started trying to talk to me and I said, oh my gosh, what happened to you? And it took us a few minutes of our style of communication that became very clear to me that he'd had a stroke during his procedure. So before he died, he gave me this bolo and said he wanted me to keep this. So when I give talks, sometimes I wear this as a reminder of what we need to, the kind of relationship we need to have with our patients. So today, I'm going to talk about fatigue. And you're going to see some interesting crossover between the things that each one of us discuss. And that's the whole point of us coming here, to talk together about this crossover. Where's my other slide? So why should a mental health provider care about fatigue? As Lee said, and as we've all learned, it's one of the most common complaints that come into the primary care office of doctors. It is a primary symptom of mental health disorders. The fatigue may be curable or treatable. You would hate to miss the opportunity to help someone with their fatigue if it's fixable. The fatigue may be incurable, debilitating, and emotionally devastating, which means you play a very important role in helping patients adjust to that fatigue and learn to live with it. So mental health therapies play a critical role in all of those kinds of fatigue, the reversible kind, the treatable kind, and the incurable type of fatigue states, and I'm going to try to talk to you about some of those today. This is my dog, Woof, named after someone in this audience, actually. And this is Woof after a long day playing in the yard, and you can see that he's so tired, he's fallen asleep, his back legs have fallen over, and he's got a paw on each of his toys. So this is the kind of fatigue that we all appreciate after exercise and hard work. But fatigue is much, much bigger than that. And I was in Hong Kong for a period of time once, and I remember one of the young Chinese translators that I worked with telling me he loved English because sometimes there was one Chinese word that would have 10 English words that meant the same thing. And he said, I can express myself so much better in English. He was so excited about learning English. Well, fatigue is the flip side of that, right? Fatigue is a word that has way too many meanings and only one spelling. And there's so many causes, even in one person, and between people, it is very difficult to communicate. It takes a lot of time and energy to try to communicate what it's like to be tired. The severity may be difficult to assess and measure, not only in the clinical setting, but in the research setting, which is why we don't have very many studies about it. And the impact on function is very critical. I want to really grind that into our minds as we talk, because there's fatigue that is the walking, talking, going around, doing things all day fatigue, and there's fatigue that makes it so people get out of their bed. That's the difference. That's the range of how fatigue, and every one of them may say their fatigue is an 8 or a 10 out of 10, but the way the fatigue impacts function may differentiate between some of the types of fatigue, but it's especially important to understand. And I don't know if, you know, this really never occurred to me, but I was talking to Alan Light, who's a researcher that I collaborate with here in the Pain Research Center, and he said we do not understand physiologically what fatigue is. We don't have measurements for it. We don't know how the brain interprets it. We have a little bit of an idea. We know in a physiology lab that if you stimulate a muscle over and over and over, the muscle will fatigue to the point that it can't contract anymore, sort of like woof. But that's not the fatigue that affects most of us. We know what to do with that fatigue. We rest, and that fatigue goes away. The rest of fatigue, we don't understand physiologically. And it's probably because we have one word to explain 100 different things. So it's hard to research. So I'm not actually going to talk about acute reversible fatigue that comes from excess mental and physical activity, like woof. And I'm not going to talk about somnolence or sleepiness that Lee alluded to that comes directly from, usually from sleep deprivation. But there's a couple of other settings where you can get somnolence. One, and I'd like everybody to remember this, this is the first thing I look at when someone comes in with somnolence, is sedating medications. So those are the two big things I think of when someone has somnolence or sleepiness during the day. And then there are other acute conditions that can make people sleepy, like acute mono, for example, or the flu. You're tired and sleepy, and you just sleep through it to see if you can get better. But those are acute conditions, and we're really not going to talk about those today. But this is a slide I want to leave up for a minute. Was there a pointer? Can I use your pointer? Oh, the bottom. Okay, excellent. So this is a chart I made and put together, pulling on a few resources. This is just one way of trying to differentiate between certain categories of fatigue. You can see why this word is kind of useless, right? But over here, I've got a list of mental health disorders and experiences. Grief, depression, anxiety, bipolar disorder, psychotic illnesses, dementia, substance abuse, eating disorders. We all know those things can lead to fatigue. Really severe fatigue. Sometimes I have patients who are bedridden immediately, suddenly, from a bipolar swing. You will probably run across patients like that. There's nothing wrong with their body. But they are so tired, they cannot function. Over here, I've kind of categorized, I'm an internal medicine specialist, but into some categories, neurologic illnesses like multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, dementia, stroke, sleep apnea. I've thrown a few things in, you know, in the neurologic category. Malignancies, whether they're active, recurrent, or after treatment. Autoimmune diseases can make people tired, rheumatoid arthritis, lupus, an infection, a chronic infection. You know, I read a published paper on chronic fatigue. One of the most common undetected infections to cause chronic fatigue is sinusitis. And if you don't know, and sometimes it's hard to detect, and once treated, the fatigue goes away. Cardiopulmonary disease, like congestive heart failure, where the pump is stretched out or not working, or other problems with your heart muscle, like coronary artery disease, any kind of lung disease that diminishes your ability to utilize oxygen, metabolic problems like anemia, vitamin deficiencies, low oxygen, obesity, hormone issues, menopause, low testosterone. So there's a long list, including lists of medications. And it's the job of a physician to dig into these and try to treat them. But I'll tell you that many of these problems, no matter how well treated, will confer some degree of fatigue on the patient, even when well compensated. I put down here at the bottom age-related fatigue because there is a natural process. Our stamina just slowly gets less as we age. Everybody knows that. I think we all feel that. You just don't last quite as long. You need to pace yourself a little more, have a little more rest. And then right here I've put fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome, which are ways of grouping patients who have pain and fatigue that don't fit in any of these other categories. And they're defined by a case definition I'd like to review with you. And Lee's given you a beautiful summary of central sensitivity and hyperalgesia and the interaction and the neurochemistry of that. Chronic fatigue syndrome may be a bit more, there's crossover and a bit more complicated. It involves the central nervous system, maybe some more role with infection, autoimmune, and autonomic dysregulation. But you know, you heard Lee hint about that, about how stress impacts all those systems in our body and the degree to which it impacts our function. may vary from person to person, but you know, chronic fatigue syndrome may be as simple as someone who gets a little bit of altered immune surveillance, gets an infection, and never fully recovers because of a series of events that happen in all those systems. We don't really know. So I put this down here because it made me smile. Lee reviewed my slides, and he said, so Cindy, it might be interesting to tell people in the audience what percentage of fatigue coming into the office is due to chronic fatigue syndrome, and what percent of fatigue is mental health versus medical disease. And I just thought, gosh, I wish I knew, because what happens when people come into my office is they have a little bit of this, a little bit of this, a little bit of this, and a little bit of this, right? They have multiple contributors to their fatigue. I really didn't go through this box, but these are kind of miscellaneous things that cross over that can dramatically impact fatigue. So medications, being deconditioned, just the more less you do, the more weak you become, less tolerant of activity, and the more tired. Just being kind of stressed and overextended and run down starts to take you down the path toward any of these. Poor sleep, HPA axis dysregulation, that's just the hormone. Endocrine part Lee was talking about, poor nutrition. And pain itself can be incredibly fatiguing. I live with someone who's experiencing low back pain. A highly energetic person who went to bed at 8 o'clock last night. The pain was just too exhausting. And at the end of the day, the pain had just pushed to the point that exhaustion set in. And the only thing to do was to just get in bed and sleep 12 hours. So any given person who walks into my office likely has a combination of these things. So let me take a moment and just remind you about the definitions of fibromyalgia syndrome and chronic fatigue syndrome, because you're going to encounter them. Fibromyalgia is defined as chronic widespread pain and tenderness, with some specifics that has to be at least 3 months. It has to be all over, defined as four quadrants in the spine. And then the patient has to be tender, and it's defined with a tender point exam. So it does separate a group of patients different than those of us who are just a little bit overextended and tired, because this has to be chronic, all over, and the tenderness has to be there, and it doesn't go away with a good night's sleep or the treatment of depression. Now, as Lee said, if we would diagnose this earlier, maybe we would feel like it was much more reversible. The longer we wait, the more irreversible it is. Fibromyalgia right now is considered an incurable chronic pain condition. And it's characterized by that hyperalgesia, but lots of things relate to that hyperalgesia. Stiffness, muscle, joint pain, headache, irritable bowel, bladder, pelvic, chest, tingling, photophobia, everything. Anything that's a sensation or like a pain is amplified in a patient with fibromyalgia with this global process. And along with that comes fatigue, cognitive complaints, and sleep disturbances. And I kind of feel like if these things aren't present, you should question the diagnosis of fibromyalgia. On the flip side, I've had doctors say, oh, everybody thinks they have fibromyalgia, you know, and patients come in and tell me they have it. And I'm like, well, guess what? If they tell you that, they probably do have it, because it is quite common. And depending on how strictly you apply the definition, but it is very, very common in our society. I think if I was in a room of 100 middle-aged women, that 10% of them would meet criteria for fibromyalgia if they applied those criteria. So it's very common, and that doesn't mean people aren't walking around dealing with it, but they don't always get to the doctor's office, and it doesn't always meet the level of disability. So how do we define chronic fatigue syndrome? We usually use what are called the Fukuda criteria, which is the reference down here, that were published in 1994, and these are all the people that are tired and impaired that we don't have another diagnosis for. It does define a heterogeneous group of people, but a very critical group of people. So they have to have fatigue that's been thoroughly evaluated. So chronic fatigue is not any other known illness causing that fatigue. Unexplained, persistent or relapsing. By the time you've done doing all this, it's usually been about 6 months. It has to be new. They can't just say, I've been tired all my life. And it must result in substantial reduction of function. And that's another thing that people don't understand when they slap the diagnosis of chronic fatigue on people. So as we defined it, this is people with fatigue that limits their ability to function normally with no other explanation. And then they say that you have to have at least 4 out of these 8 symptoms. And I'm going to point out the red are fibromyalgia symptoms. So if a fibromyalgia, someone we call fibromyalgia who has widespread pain, they're tired, they have concentration issues, and they have unrefreshing sleep, that many people that we might diagnose with fibromyalgia could also meet the criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome if their disorder limits their ability to function normally. So these are not exclusive diagnoses, they're descriptive categories based on the symptoms. I would like to point out that most people who study chronic fatigue syndrome think that this particular symptom, post-exertional malaise, should be elevated to a mandatory symptom, because there is definitely a group that do not tolerate exercise and become much more ill when they're pushed more physically. And we think this should be the hallmark of this illness. And in fact, there's another case definition I'm not going to go over called the 2003 Canadian definition that elevates post-exertional malaise to one of the primary symptoms. Otherwise, these are pretty much the same as the other with a little bit more. And this is a clinical definition that we use in the field. So how important is chronic fatigue syndrome? I just put these in because I think there's a very minimal understanding generally about what this syndrome is. It was defined by the Centers for Disease Control, and they've done several big epidemiologic studies. One was done in Wichita and one was done in Georgia. They were separated by a number of years, and they used slightly different methods, and so the results were strikingly different, but they're still impressive. And that is, at least 1 million people in the U.S., based on Wichita criteria, meet those CFS criteria. That means they've been evaluated, they're not depressed, they don't have another medical illness, they meet those CFS criteria. And if you use the Georgia study, it was 4 million people. But what's even more frightening is twice that many people met the criteria over the phone. But when they brought them in and evaluated them, they found other medical issues or mental health issues that they could resolve. So they didn't end up meeting criteria for chronic fatigue syndrome. But that is a huge number of people in our country impacted by fatigue and pain and disordered sleep and basically in some state of disability. Remember, that's part of the criteria, that they have to be significantly disabled by their illness. And what was even worse, when they did their epidemiologic study, is more than 80% of the people had never been diagnosed. They were just discovered with this epidemiologic study. So how much does this impact us? A pretty recent study, this was published in January of 2011. Again, this is the CDC study based on those Georgia data. They just estimated the cost in Georgia as being $1.65 billion per year in lost in healthcare expenditures and lost productivity, lost wages, inability to bring money into the family, and all the money they spend on their illness. Can you imagine the cost to our society? And this is just the more disabled people, right? Because people with less fatigue who meet fibromyalgia criteria or have other issues were not included in this. And there was an earlier study done by Lenny Jason, a little bit more conservative, but even that study, this was published in 2008, was that in the entire U.S., $24 billion a year in healthcare costs and lost productivity from chronic fatigue syndrome, as defined by the CDC criteria. So this is not just a pet issue. This is a huge public health problem that's basically seldom diagnosed, and the patients with these disorders are kind of caught in between their medical providers and mental health providers, because the mental health providers don't really understand the medical aspect, and the medical providers won't access them and don't understand the mental health part. So I wanted to throw in two other aspects, just to talk a little bit about some subsets of people with chronic fatigue syndrome. There have been studies showing that infection can lead to a clinical scenario that can be defined as chronic fatigue syndrome. And they looked in, this was done in Australia. It was funded by the Centers for Disease Control. And they took three common community infections in Australia that many people get. They enrolled people in the study, 253 patients, when they got sick. So the Epstein-Barr virus patients had acute mono when they were enrolled, and they tracked them for 3 years. But at the one-year mark, 11% of people with any of those infections met the CFS criteria, except that we knew why they had it, why they were sick, right? So it wasn't unexplained in that case. However, if you had drawn their blood or seen them in assessment at the one-year mark, there wouldn't have been one test you could do to show what had caused them to be ill, because antibody titers are elevated in everybody after Epstein-Barr virus. So the sick ones and the well ones would look the same with blood tests. So we have out there, oh, and the only risk factor for this group, they looked into, who knows how well they looked into it. They looked into their mental health illnesses, what's going on in their lives, all kinds of things. The only thing that predicted who'd be in this group was how sick they were with the primary infection, how severe the infection was. We also have a study in the U.S. It's, I think, relevant to us. I was glad they did it. Prospective studies are very hard to do. They enrolled 300 teenagers in a study who got mono, EBV mono, and they looked at them at 6, 12, 24 months, and this is the number who met criteria for CFS. So 3 years after acute mono, 4% of these kids met CFS criteria. That means they wouldn't be able to attend school full-time, or they wouldn't be able to do other activities with their friends. You know, they would be limited in their ability to function. So, and it turned out that they were all girls. And we know that both fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome are more likely to happen in women, although there's still a significant number in men. And we know from research over the last couple of decades, a chronic fatigue syndrome meeting those criteria can happen after EBV, cytomegalovirus, HHV6, West Nile virus, parvovirus, and more. So hidden out there among us are people who get sick with the virus and never regain, or seem for a very, very long time not to regain their normal level of health, and we don't really have a way of doing any kind of test to show why they're ill. We don't know why they're ill. We don't know if they still have infection. There's never been a study to prove they're still infected. We don't know if those viruses reactivate. Maybe. There may be a chronic immune response. It's possible it just sets in motion that cascade that Lee was talking about of dysfunction centrally. But we still have a lot of questions. And at this, really no diagnostic test for chronic fatigue syndrome, although I'm going to tease you with a few in a minute. The second whole process I want to talk about that's been studied in chronic fatigue syndrome is what we call orthostatic intolerance. And that's just a big general term to say that when people stand up, their cardiovascular system doesn't support normal blood flow. Their blood pressure may drop, their heart might race, they may get a little lightheaded, they may get areas of their body that don't get vigorous blood flow. And there's a couple of terms for it that fall under that umbrella. Neurally mediated hypotension means for sure that their blood pressure drops from that. And POTS means that their heart races when they stand up. And this is what happens to teenagers. And this all started in 1995 when Peter Rowe, a pediatrician at Johns Hopkins, took his chronic fatigue syndrome patients and put them on a tilt table. And almost all of them, 22 out of 23 patients, had an abnormal tilt table test. And it was the first time anybody'd ever looked. And I want to tell you, sadly, that nobody in primary care, hardly anybody in primary care, still evaluates a chronic fatigue syndrome patient for orthostatic intolerance. And that was in 1995. But there are some studies going on looking at tilt table testing and brain blood flow using transcranial Doppler. And this is just a picture of a tilt table test. It's simple, the patient's horizontal, attached to the board so they don't fall off if they faint or have a problem. And the table's tilted up like this for the duration of the test. And I'm going to show you some data of tilt table testing in normal people and people with chronic fatigue syndrome who have POTS. That's the postural orthostatic tachycardia. And I'm going to look at three graphs. One is heart rate, one is their breathing, and one is their carbon dioxide. These red lines, if you can see them, are when the tilt table begins and ends. And just extend those red lines down into the patient group also. And you can see that a normal person, when the table tilts, doesn't have too much change in their heart rate. But the minute the table tilts, the heart rate jumps up and stays much higher in the people with CFS, and then it goes back down when the table is put back down. What does that mean clinically for a teenager who had mono when they try to stand up and their heart rate goes from 80 to 130 and their blood pressure drops too? They feel horrible and they don't get normal blood flow. Meanwhile, their breathing gets chaotic as opposed to the normal people. They hyperventilate while they're on the tilt table test. And because they hyperventilate, here's the carbon end-tidal CO2, the carbon dioxide levels. Look what happens to the patients on the tilt. They hyperventilate, their end-tidal carbon dioxide goes down, and they feel very, very ill and get all kinds of strange symptoms, just like anxiety patients do when they hyperventilate. While that's going on, I think probably this is what's happening. This is causing this. This is blood volume. The red ones are the people with CFS and POTS. Leave their thorax, this is a negative, and go right down into their abdomen. So their blood volume when they stand up goes funk down like that. You can measure it. Huge volume shifts, which is what makes their heart race and makes them feel horrible in their chest. So they hyperventilate. What happens up in the brain when this is happening? Here's the beginning of the tilt. Here's the end of the tilt. This is two ways of measuring blood flow. One is mean arterial pressure, and the other is cerebral blood flow. The black are the normal people, and the gray are the POTS. You can see that as soon as the tilt starts, their arterial pressures up in their brain go down, and their blood flow goes down in their brain. What does that do to someone when they stand up and the blood flow to their brain is diminished? They may have cognitive issues. They may feel tired. They may have a headache. There's also a paper published about irritable bowel, that a patient who has this kind of blood flow problems can get irritable bowel symptoms. It's because the blood is shunted away from the gut, which is part of what happens when you're relaxed and eating, and goes into more of a mode where the gut is deprived of blood. The heart is pumping the blood to the most critical areas, like the muscles and what it can do up to the brain. So orthostatic intolerance plays an important role, and it's hardly ever diagnosed and treated. And it does have some things, there are some things we can do I won't go into today. So I'm going to leave that. I just wanted to tantalize you and let you see there's some interesting research going on. There are multiple causes, including stress and sleep deprivation and comorbid mood disorders, but there may be other things at play that make our patients very ill. And this is something I made for a talk at a kind of a brainstorming scientific meeting about subgroups of CFS. And this is how much heterogeneity I see in my office. And these people, most of them meet criteria for CFS. So these are people that really, there's no other single disorder that explains their fatigue. So this is post-viral fatigue, like a young person who gets mono and then they get orthostatic problems, may wax and wane. That's one group of patients. You may not be able to go to school. Here's another group of patients. This is more middle age. They get a devastating flu-like onset, get horrible cognitive dysfunction, and often very severe CFS, and maybe can't go back to work. There's another kind of a situation, gradual onset, weeks to months of stress, mental and physical stress. They often get more pain. Sometimes it happens when there are other hormonal things going on, like perimenopause, they're not sleeping, they may have depression and anxiety, and this would be the typical patient to develop fibromyalgia-like symptoms, but they have quite bad fatigue. These are the patients that have a dramatic series of events in their life. I have a patient who was diagnosed with cancer. He went into the hospital. He had major surgery. Then there was a surgical complication. He got infections. He had to go back. They had to go back for more of his cancer, and finally he was cured. But when it was all over, he was completely disabled. He started at a hospital administrator. And when everything was said and done, he cannot keep his checkbook. And he has horrible orthostatic intolerance, he can't exercise, and he can barely do activities of daily living around his house. So catastrophic combo, I don't know, was it stress? Was it anesthesia? Was it an infection? Was it a big event where he didn't get blood to his brain during a surgery? We don't know, but they all, I have many patients who have these complex series of events and are left disabled. Then there are patients with anxiety disorders that develop severe fatigue, and this is actually not exclusionary for the CFS criteria. They don't even mention anxiety as being a contributor possibly to chronic fatigue. And of course, bipolar disorder, and this does exclude people from a research definition of CFS. Then I believe sometimes I have people who have another illness, but it doesn't meet criteria yet. So they won't get diagnosed. Say they have MS, but they don't have enough findings of MS to get a diagnosis from a neurologist. Or they have a little atypical presentation of MS. So we have to be kind of careful that they're not, you know, a lupus or an endocrine disorder or genetic diseases or any rare diseases that don't niche, and the people are sick, but they have to be able to, you have to live with them and help them and help them cope with their illness along with no answers and no definitive treatment. And then the last category, I say lovingly, are the train wreck patients. They just got too many things wrong with them, right? They've got mental health issues, they've got pain syndromes, they've got asthma, they've got diabetes or pre-diabetes, they have the sleep apnea, and they can't do anything, and they've gotten more overweight, and they have this combination of issues that render them disabled. No single one fatiguing enough to be disabling, but when you put them all together, patient is rendered relatively disabled. So you can see that there's a lot to work on here, right? But we have to reserve judgment and remember that simple word fatigue has to cover all these people, and we have to understand how to use our tools to determine function and start to tease apart what the different contributors are to their fatigue. And I'm going to tell you, this is not done very well in the medical office. We can do a set of blood tests, but many doctors spend 10 minutes with their patients. They'll draw their blood, do a quick exam, send them out. There is no way to tease through all those issues in the medical office. So that leaves a very important role for better communication, both with the medical providers, but also an important role for mental health providers to improve on that communication. So that is the first step in assessing fatigue. It's talking. It's listening. It's teasing through the layers. I call it peeling the layers of the onion to my patients, because everyone walks in, and I can usually, once I finish their assessment, make a list of 10 things that might be contributing to their fatigue. Poor sleep, deconditioning, unrelieved pain, you know, mental health issues, maybe their thyroid needs to be tweaked. There's a lot, but it can't be solved simply. It has to be solved with the art of medicine, with the skill you bring to taking care of the patient. That still is the main thing, but I'm going to go through some tools, a little bit of tools that we might be able to use to assess our patients. Numeric rating scales. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about a tool called the SF36 you might be able to use in your clinic. The fibromyalgia impact questionnaire is also wonderful. You can, either one of these, you can put in Google and come up with these tests and apply them to your patients. The fibromyalgia impact questionnaire is a very short questionnaire to see how patients are functioning. I'm going to say a minute about this because this is something I've been doing in my clinic for about 18 months, and I'm not going to talk about it anymore in additional slides, but I ask patients how much time they spend with their feet on the floor versus their feet in the air. Hours of upright activity, and that includes sitting, standing, and walking. Most of my patients with chronic fatigue syndrome put 4 to 6 in 24 hours. That's stunning, isn't it? And most fibromyalgia patients who are otherwise more functional will put 10 to 12. You know, when they get home, they got to put their feet up, they got to be careful, you know, they have rest and recuperation time. You can also judge fatigue by how fatigue responds to exercise, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. Most conditions do better When people become more fit, when they do low impact exercise, they stretch, they get out, mental health problems get better, fibromyalgia improves with exercise. Many people with chronic fatigue syndrome, you can put them down with exercise. You can make them so ill that they'll be sick for several weeks. So that's important. And then I also assess fatigue by how it responds to my interventions. That's simple enough. So I think people are depressed, I treat them for depression. If an element of their fatigue goes away, I know I hit the button on that one. If they're not sleeping, we work on their sleep. So this is a picture of numeric rating scales. This is one I use in my clinic. Just simple. This is, they're feeling the best, this is feeling the worst. And here's a visit. Because I have a specialty clinic, every single person fills this out before I talk to them. And you can see how these symptoms cluster. I've got a few more in my office, but they all cluster together. Any place that is typical for pain. This is a very understated guy who's been sick for a long time and isn't asking for anything. He's just there for refills of his meds. And he's quite functional and doing well. He's stable, put it that way. He's 50% of normal function, maybe 30 to 50% of normal function. Here's another one of my patients who has a very severe mental health overlay on top of her fatigue and pain. You can see that, I don't think you can see this, everyone says 10 plus. And this is her list of medicines that keeps going. And she takes the form home and fills it out before she comes. She's got OCD along with her other illnesses, and she scribbles so hard it goes through the paper. But she needs about an hour to fill this out before she comes, so she does it before she comes. All right, let me talk a minute about SF-36 and how you can use this as a valuable tool to assess. The proprietary test is called the SF-36. That's a test you can, if you do it in bulk, it's not terribly expensive. You get sent the forms, then you turn them back in and they're scored for you, right? And that makes it, and that's what we do in research. But there is a version of the SF-36 that's free. It's called the RAND-36. And I've put the RAND descriptions here and the SF-36 descriptions in parentheses. And these are the SF-36 initials. So there are the 8 categories on this survey, and they assess physical functioning, how physical health alters their role, how emotional health issues also alter their role, their energy or vitality, their emotional well-being, social functioning, pain, and then general health. This is a little study we did using exercise. I'm not actually going to talk about the study. I'm just going to show you that we had normal controls in our study, and these are their SF-36 scores before, during, and after exercise. Doesn't matter. They all cluster together. Here's their physical fatigue, their role physical, their bodily pain, general health, vitality, social functioning, role emotional, and their mental health. These are the CFS patients that we asked to come take, do this exercise study. Does it strike you that their emotional and mental health scores are not that different from our normal controls? What's wrong with them is they have pain and fatigue, and it's dramatic. And this was just, we just did this as an outcome measure in our study. We were a little disappointed because they didn't separate very well after exercise. The lower line would be their scores after they did the exercise study, and the other 2 points are before. Oh, I see, the lower point is their 7-day. So you can see they did have a sort of sustained decrease in their function after they did an exercise study in our office. And these are national, this is a colleague of mine just took vitality score, that's that the vitality score, and looked at the SF-36 vitality score across different conditions. Here's the general population of 60. Remember, here's our general population, here's their vitality score. Our groups on our study had a little better vitality score. We picked people who were walking, talking, younger. Here's a vitality score. Remember, high is good on this and low is bad. People with depression, cancer in remission, rheumatologic diseases like lupus, cystic fibrosis. Here are the CFS patients. Their fatigue level, it almost matches perfectly with what we measured in our study. See that? Here are fibro patients, not quite so, you know, average fibromyalgia patient doesn't have as much fatigue, COPD, and congestive heart failure. So people with CFS, by definition, and by the way their illness is, have severe, severe fatigue, and not necessarily as much mental health issues going on. I want to talk to you about some research that we did with Alan and Kathy Light in this research group, and I've put the two papers published so far, actually there's more than that, and a whole host of papers that are going to come out of this research. But when I talked to Alan and Kathy Light about my interest in these patients who can't exercise, Alan and Kathy devised a study to make them sick and see if we could measure it. So we got our CFS patients in healthy controls. We drew their blood before they exercised. We had them exercise on this bike for 25 minutes, just continuing to pedal and move their arms. It wasn't an exercise to exhaustion. They just had to keep going for 25 minutes. And then we analyzed their blood. And what we looked for in their blood, if you think back to Lee's talk, we looked at immune markers. These are cytokines. We looked at adrenergic markers, alpha and beta receptors. This has to do with that sympathetic nervous system and their blood pressure and orthostatic intolerance, the adrenaline, the norepinephrine. And then we looked at some research-based receptors in the nervous system that we think might tell us more about pain and fatigue. None of these are available in a regular lab. This is done in the research lab. And we have our control patients. We measured their levels of all of these before they did the exercise. Here's the exercise. Then we drew their blood four more times to see if there was any change in these markers. Not much, a little bit, kind of interesting. Here's what happened when the CFS patients exercised on the bike. Baseline levels, no different than the controls. They exercised for 25 minutes, and within 30 minutes, they had dramatic gene expression across all those modalities. Now, to discuss the science of this is beyond the scope of this talk. I just want to tell you, when I show this to a patient with chronic fatigue syndrome, they cry. And they say, I've been trying to tell people that for years, and no one's listened to me, and now I can see it. I also want to tell you that none of my very sick patients went and did this study, because you told them, I would tell them about the study, they'd get big, huge eyes and say, there's no way I could go do that exercise test. I would be so sick, I wouldn't get out of bed for 2 weeks. So this is our medium patients. And we've tested others. Al and Kathy have continued to test others. These are MS patients whose primary symptom is fatigue, just 9 people. They also took a group of patients and exercised them vigorously, high intensity, for the 25 minutes. And you can see there was some activity, but nothing like this. And these were deconditioned controls. So this has become very important. And Al called me and he said, can you rank those patients for me, the patients that we've done? I think we started with 30 patients. So I assigned them a score based on my knowledge of the patient, whether or not they were super sick, unable to live alone, dependent on help for everything, or whether they were sort of a half-time person who could, you know, maintain school or work about half-time, so moderately ill. And he reanalyzed the data. He clumped all the times together, and these were the patients who were most sick down to the patients who were the least sick. So we think there's pretty good correlation, these biomarkers, for the severity of chronic fatigue syndrome. These are the control patients, and the dots down below show statistical significance. So you have statistical significance even in the least sick patients. So we're working on trying to understand what these biomarkers might mean to actually draw the blood, right, and see if we could tell what's going on with our patients, with their pain and fatigue. And this is one of my 24-year-old patients who meets criteria for both CFS and fibro. Wonderful. She's got some anxiety. She deals with it. We've got her treated. She's very stable. She can work about 8 hours a week or go to school about 8 hours a week. She can do just a tiny bit of exercise. See that? That. And she's a very compliant patient. When we put her on the treadmill, here's what her biomarkers showed. So right here she exercised. There's 30 minutes, 8 hours, 24, and 48 hours after that single bout of exercise compared to our control patients. And here she is, a different way of monitoring her symptoms. Excuse me, let's So here is just a rating of fatigue. The patient saying how tired they were before the exercise. This is physical fatigue during the exercise, after, then 38 hours, 24. And here are the control patients. They get a little tired while they're on the bike, and then it comes back down. Here are the fibromyalgia patients. Here are the CFS. The ones that have the worst numbers are people who have pain and fatigue. And here's my patient, my 23-year-old, 48 hours after doing the exercise test. And here's her ranking of mental fatigue after the exercise test. The control patients didn't experience any mental fatigue during or after the exercise. Here are the fibro patients, here's the CFS patients, and here's my patient. She's young, she felt pretty good when she started. Here's 30 minutes, 8 hours, 24, 48 hours after one bout of exercise on the exercise bike for 25 minutes. And those correlate with those biomarkers. And just to top this off, we picked 20 patients with fibromyalgia from my practice who were pretty high functioning, working full time, going about their business, well controlled on their medicines. We made them come off their medicines and do the exercise test, and guess what? They look just like our control patients. So those biomarkers have to do with function, the fatigue that puts people down, that makes them extremely ill. And Al and Kathy discovered that even though they did not have much going on after exercise, there were some small markers that differentiated them from normal people even before they exercise. So they're looking to see if we can find, it's not that they don't have something wrong, right? They do, they have that hyperalgesia and chronic pain, but it's something a little different than the people with devastating fatigue. We think gene expression may become a diagnostic tool in the future, and we're working toward that to determine subtypes of chronic fatigue. And I want to just show you some very interesting, you know, down the road data. When you do gene expression in all these groups of patients, you know, it's a big array of genes and what the genes are producing. If you pick the genes that differentiate the most and cluster them together and develop what's called a Z-score, look how you can divide fibromyalgia patients from controls. Not too bad. If you put a cutoff right here, there's three people above and only one fibro patient below. See the zero mark? Not bad for distinguishing based on a blood draw. By the way, these were before the exercise. This is just drawing the blood in patients. This is my fibro patients. Remember, these are my high-functioning fibro patients who'd come off their meds compared to patients about to undergo ECT for severe depression. This is a blood draw. This is my fibro patients, or my CFS patients. A little bit difficult though. Right? There's a big overlap in how we define CFS and fibro. They're not really mutually distinct. Yeah. Oh, by the way, those post-exercise biomarkers in the CFS patients had no relationship to whether they had pain or not. The same whether they had pain and fatigue or just fatigue. And you can see that we didn't do very well distinguishing CFS from controls at baseline. You had to make them exercise. When they exercise, the difference is huge. And here are the CFS patients from the people about to undergo ECT, major depressive disorder, more overlap, because I didn't screen my patients with CFS for depression. They came on the study whether they had depression or not. And here's the most interesting one. When you look at 14 genes, this is on white blood cells, you can distinguish controls from this group of major depression patients in this study who were severely depressed patients about to undergo ECT almost 100% with a blood draw. How's that for exciting? So down the road, we may have better ways to distinguish fatigue, but right now, we don't have any. So all we have are our brains and our numeric scales and our discussions and our paying attention to how people respond to exercise. And so this is a general paradigm I have for management when patients come to my clinic, and it's pretty straightforward. First of all, we do our best to diagnose and treat their medical problems. Second is we try to teach them how to pace their activity to minimize relapse symptoms, and that's different for every patient. Some people can do a lot and some people can't, but what they need to do is not have disease state active all the time. Those CFS patients, if they reduce their activity and do things in small amounts, all that gene expression goes away. They can sometimes can't exercise on serial days. we looked at that, right? On day two, day one and day two, their disease state was still wildly active. If they go exercise on day two and, you know, the day after and the day after that, they stack up their pathology and they become disabled. They end up in bed, so ill they can't do anything. So I use this, so first we diagnose and treat other conditions. The most important thing we teach patients is how to pace their activity mentally and physically. And then and this is what I use to teach primary care doctors, is we address the four legs of the table, and you can use the same paradigm. And so if this is the patient's well-being and their fatigue, it rests strongly on these four legs, the mental health, and not just their diseases, but their personality, attitudes, beliefs, knowledge, coping, resilience, taking in mind their resources, all the things you can do to help them, it becomes one huge leg of the table. And if you don't treat all four legs of the table, they don't do well. You have to treat all four. Here's sleep and pain that Lee talked about. For pain, we work to understand the causes, trying to tease apart the cause. That's the medical aspect. But look here, restore control, reduce fear of pain, relaxation. We may touch with medications, but be careful not to worsen other legs of the table and try not to get too reliant on medications, which makes this an important leg of the table for mental health providers. What about sleep? Yes, they need a medical assessment to know if they've got sleep apnea. We might try to end up using some medications, but mostly it's what can be taught by mental health providers, is how do you approach sleep? How do you relax? How do you do sleep hygiene? Because this has to be managed by the patient. The other leg of the table for every patient, including the CFS patients, is figuring out how to reduce their deconditioning. Because the more weak and deconditioned you are, the worse every problem is. The worse pain is, the worse sleep is, the worse the mood. Your orthostatic intolerance is worse if you don't have a good muscular support. So we work on conditioning, pacing, and then the consequences, diet and gaining weight when you can't even burn calories. So you can see all four legs of the table rest squarely in both the medical and the mental health realm, and we need to work together to try to help people. I like to add that it's tempting to just try to treat the fatigue with a drug, but that it really, in most people, is not the first answer, second answer, or third answer. My philosophy is you treat all the legs of the table, all their medical problems. And the ones who tend to be the most responsive to drugs like stimulants or bupropion or other drugs like that are the people who have more mental health problems and fibromyalgia. They have the sensory problems where you can alter those neurotransmitters centrally. A CFS patient who has severe exercise intolerance, you give them a stimulant, they feel like they can do more, and they go do more, and then they crash harder and become more ill. So we can use small doses of stimulants for them to drive or to go to their class, but they have to be very careful not to alter their activity any more than they would if they didn't take the stimulant, or they end up having more disability from their activity than they had before they started. In this slide, I just want to emphasize that sick CFS patients, this term right here, is myalgic encephalomyelitis, which is the term we're trying to bring in to try to minimize the focus on this kind of demeaning and simplistic term, chronic fatigue syndrome. These patients who meet criteria for more ill have less mental health overlap except secondary mood symptoms. They need grief work and chronic illness adaptation. They need your help with their families, at work. How do they get over the loss of everything that's their identity? Their pain doesn't respond as predictably to fibromyalgia drugs. Sometimes getting them to sleep is very, very difficult because they don't tolerate medicines. And they have a hard time working on their fitness, and we have to be very careful about how we work on that. But we do work on it in every patient. So how do we assess progress? How do we know we're making a difference in the patients? Certainly, improve mental health and coping. I have lots of patients with CFS and fibromyalgia who do not have active mood disorder and who are very well adapted and coping well. So I know it can be, I can see it. They need the tools and the information, and then they go on and live with their illness. No one should have to put up with daytime somnolence. That's not fatigue. That's medications, that's sleep problems. We should improve their physical function, but I want to say, think about this. Symptoms may not improve because the upper limit of function causes emergence of symptoms, right? So what I mean is you make people feel better, they'll do as much as they can until their symptoms stop them. So if you just measure symptoms, you're missing the progress. You need to measure function. So as people take on more, they get out more, most people who are mentally healthy or, you know, within the realm of wanting to get better, as long as they're not malingerers or people who have really low coping skills, they'll do more when they feel better. And they will do it until they can't. And so their symptoms will stay high. So we can use symptoms to gauge when to pull back, actually, when to stop before you get to the place where you're suffering more disease. And patients should be able to pace better and have better activity management. And that is another measure of progress, if they've learned to recognize, have insight, and understand how to pace their symptoms. So the role of mental health providers, huge. To assess mental health, to provide emotional support, move through stages of grief and loss, teach pacing, relaxation, distraction, coping for sleep, pain, fitness, and stress reduction, help with family and relationship issues, which become profound in people who are disabled by pain and fatigue, and strategies for how to function in the workplace with all these symptoms. So here's Woof on the leather ottoman that he chewed to say goodbye and to wish you good luck and hope that we can all collaborate better in working with our patients in fatigue. Thanks.